Raga. We were talking about the clashes and we talked about raga or attachment in some detail. The next klesha is dvesha. Dvesha means aversion. Aversion is what results from pain and misery. Aversion is the flip side of attachment. Either aversion or attachment keeps us in bondage. If you think of an example such as cigarettes or alcohol, you have an addiction to it, you're very attached to it. Or you may even have an aversion. You may have an aversion towards cigarettes, alcohol, and you may be very bothered by cigarette smoke, for example. And that is also an aversion. It's very similar if you see whether you are attached or you have an aversion for something. You are still bound in some way. There is a connection with that object. So also, when people have very strong dislike for a certain person, always remember this, that disliking a person is pretty much similar to being very attached to a person, because in some way or the other, your mind will be preoccupied with that person. Contemplate on this idea. It's a very important idea because you realize that they both are the flip side of the same coin. A lot of people think that when they have an aversion or they don't like somebody, they are not attached, when in fact, it is a form of attachment. It's just a negative form of attachment. So, not much difference there. Any questions about aversion? Since we talked a lot about attachment last time, and there is not much difference between the two, there is not so much to talk about aversion unless you have any specific questions to that. Aversions can also keep us very blocked or can keep our energies occupied, just as attachment. Just as attachment prevents us from expanding our consciousness, so does aversion. So it seems that everybody is quite clear about that. I'll continue to verse 9 of chapter 2. The fear of death, called Abhinavesh, is strongly present in the ignorant as well as the learned. Abhinavesh, the fear of death. While it is often translated as fear of death, Abhinavesh means clinging to life. It's not so much as we are afraid of death, but it's more that we cling on to what we know. We do not know death. We do not have a very clear recollection of death. We have very faint memories of death. For those who do not accepted the idea of reincarnation, this might be difficult, but for everybody else, we have gone through many incarnations, evolved at every level, and so we have memories, very ancient memories of this. These ancient memories are called vasanas. Samskaras are also similar, but they're not ancient. Vasanas are very, very ancient memories. And death is one of these kind of vasanas that are very ancient because they leave impressions in us. These impressions are now very vague, diffused. So we don't have a clear understanding why we fear death, why we get uneasy about it, but we do. We cling on, therefore, to what we know, to this plane of consciousness, and we fear the unknown, the hidden. We have a visual of death. Yeah, that's how death looks. I hope the visual is clear. I think it's not really very clear, but it will have to do. We know this diagram because this is the anatomy of a person, of a being. Could be any being. It doesn't have to be a human being. So this is the yogic anatomy. This is how we look. Only when we die, this is separated here. There's a separation. So you have the center of consciousness that we all are familiar with here. We're all familiar with the latent unconscious and the active unconscious. In the earlier diagrams that we know so well, this is connected with this part here, with the conscious mind, with the breath, the body, and the senses. In death, there is a break, there's a separation. The mortal self, which is conscious mind, breath, body, and senses, this falls away, it drops away. And what is left? This is left. These three things are left. The center of consciousness, the and the latent mind and the active unconscious mind. These three are left. These three together are called jiva-atman. The jiva is the latent and active unconscious mind. It's like a bed, and the center of consciousness is in this bed, and it's a seed. Center of consciousness is like a seed in a flower bed, for example. And these seeds here, which are in the mind, these are samskaras. They are in the latent and the active unconscious mind, and they stay there. And when the opportunity arises again, they grow into another body. So this is how death looks. So any questions so far on this picture? Death is separation. If we go to our original diagram, we'd see there that yogic anatomy, this is how a person or a being looks. There is no separation. When the separation occurs, here, that's death. So generally, we are one whole being with center of consciousness, unconscious mind, breath, body, and senses. All well connected with each other. It's all one. But at death, there is a separation. And because we do not know how it is when we die, we have very, very faint memories, vague recollection. And what remains is basically this fear of leaving this plane of existence. We forget what comes later. So since our awareness is not so sharp, we do not remember. When we expand our consciousness, we have a different approach to death. But until then, there is a very deep fear. Another aspect of death is also death of identities. We see that Abhinavesh is not merely about the physical body dying or the conscious mind dying. It is also about identities. So when we practice meditation, we talk about unlearning. What is it that we are unlearning? We are unlearning the habit patterns, behavioral and emotional habit patterns. These habit patterns have been given to us partly through our upbringing, partly we have acquired these ourselves and reinforced these ideas. So we need to unlearn these habit patterns. So thinking in behavioral habit patterns are basically self-identity. That's what personality is. It's a collection of our behavioral and thinking habit patterns. And when, through meditation, we start challenging these, it is an experience very similar to death, which is why a lot of people are afraid of meditation. Fear of meditation actually shows that the person has in fact attained something, because he is beginning to work with habit patterns. So you need to go through that phase where you might begin to have difficulties in meditation, where you struggle because you keep facing habit patterns that you look at and realize, I need to work with this habit pattern. You may face identities also in our day-to-day life. If you have an identity which is very attached to your youthful appearance, then the day you find your first gray hair, this self-identity is shattered. It feels under attack because you realize that youthful self-image that you had created is not going to hold on for a very long time. If you have an idea, a lot of men have this idea that they're very good at driving, and there seems to be a kind of a joke about women not being able to park cars. But if you challenge a man who maybe has this kind of concept, classical idea, challenge him and question his ability to park a car, you would be attacking his self-identity, the identity of being a man. And while that may be amusing for us right now, for those men who are really attached to this idea, this is a serious attack. Self-identity is just another word for ahankara. While ahankara has been interpreted very often in a very negative sense, ahankara is also useful. It helps us interact with the world. So ahankara is not necessarily all bad. We also have good habit patterns, which are useful for us. We have habit patterns which are useful for us to learn meditation, for example, and help us to be liberated. So, Abhinavesh has two parts. One is the fear of leaving this plane of existence, and the other part is these self-identities, Ahankara, being questioned, being challenged, being attacked, either in daily life or during the process of unlearning in meditation. So, those who are young, youthful, I mean, even children, for example, don't really think much about death, because this fear of death, this klesha, is dormant. But as we get older, we start thinking about this. Klesha starts getting active. Remember, we talked about the different kleshas. They were dormant, active, interrupted, and attenuated. What do we do with this klesha of death? In childhood, it's generally dormant. We don't even think about it. So it's sleeping. As we get older, we try not to think about it. But there may be times you're rudely forced to think about death when someone close to you dies, maybe a parent or a grandparent or somebody close to you dies tragically, and you get a rude shock. And for a moment or two, you think about death, and then it's interrupted again. That's the interrupted pleasures. You don't think about it anymore. As you get older and your death comes closer, and you know it's coming closer, you start thinking about it more. The klesha gets more active. Through meditation, we can attenuate this fear. And the way to do it is to go back to our lovely diagram here, is through consciousness, turning our awareness inward. As we turn our awareness from the body inward, you realize you're not only the body, there's something deeper. So your initial fears of losing the body are attenuated, are weakened. As you further unlearn your thinking habit patterns, which is the conscious mind, that's what you have created, you begin to realize that there is more than just the conscious mind, just the personality. And if the conscious mind should die in the sense of these habit patterns being unlearned, there is still somebody there who you really are. And as you pass through the unconscious mind, these impressions that you have filled or have been filled for you through your upbringing, you begin to see this light at the end of the tunnel, so to say, and you see that there is something else which is permanent, which is eternal, undying. And you finally realize that center of consciousness, that is who I am. And when that happens, you lose the fear of death, because the fear of death is still here somewhere at the level of the latent unconscious or active unconscious. It's not here at the center of consciousness. So when you go beyond these aspects of the mind, You become free, you're liberated. So, questions about this from Manash? For a liberated person, does the unconscious mind not exist? That's exactly true. There are, of course, definitions of sages. So you have Jivanmukts, you have Siddhas, and then you have the fully liberated one. And such a liberated soul, that's a free soul, has no more seeds here. The jiva has been set free, or is the atman, sorry, has been set free. The jiva does not exist anymore because all the kleshas, all the samskaras have been burnt in the fire of knowledge. That is what we're going to discuss in the next verses, because the next part is about breaking the alliance and dealing with the deeper coloring and breaking the alliance of karma and samskaras. Any other questions related to death or to this particular subject? Okay, in that case, we can continue to the next verse. Verses 10 and 11 deal with deeper coloring. The kleshas can get very deep. And how do we deal with these kleshas? So the first verse is verse 10. The subtle ones, the subtle kleshas, can be destroyed by resolving them back to the original state. This was exactly what I showed you right now, that when consciousness turns inwards and all the kleshas which are in the unconscious mind are burnt, reduced to burnt seed or roasted seed. That is when the self, the individual self, is set free. This is resolving them, going back to the original state. This is when it's all gone and the person is liberated. This is only possible when these kleshas have been burnt in the fire of knowledge. For those who are interested, this is what is called the awakening of Kundalini, but mastery, not merely awakening, but learning to lead the Kundalini and learning to lead it back, raising it up and learning to lead it back. This is complete mastery. Such a free master is called an arhat. And such a master can choose to come back to help others, to serve others, to free others from their ignorance. These seeds or kleshas, it's not like they go away. They're there, but they are roasted. We know that about seeds, that they have a potential to grow. If If you plant it in a flower bed, for example, a plant will grow out of it, it will flower. But if that same seed is taken and roasted, it no longer has the potential to grow into a flower. So the seed remains, but it has no power. That means that you may continue to live in this world, but you will, some of the things that earlier may have caused you to get angry no longer will make you angry. Or that which earlier attracted you and you got greedy about it no longer has the power to make you greedy. So in this way, you can quite imagine this, that you become a person that's completely different from the one you were before. It's a complete self-transformation. It's very likely that people around you will not be able to relate to you because they are relating from their own kleshas. But if you are not relating to people from your kleshas because you don't have any, it confuses everybody. So this is an important verse, verse 10, because this tells us that total liberation, kaivalya, is only possible by destroying all the kleshas, by burning them in the fire of knowledge until they become like parched seeds or roasted seeds. Verse 11 tells us that the more active states of the kleshas can be destroyed through dhyana, through meditation. The word meditation in English is very unclear. It's not clearly defined. It means different things to different people. To some people, meditation means observing the breath, sitting still for hours together, like some Zen monks do. To some people, going for a walk is a form of meditation, or painting, or to dance is some form of meditation. For others, gardening or doing any kind of work is meditation. Here, we are not talking about that kind of meditation. We are talking about dhyana. It's a technical word from the Yoga Sutras. We will be going into that in chapter 3. So, what happens in dhyana is basically that you learn to look at the kleshas or the samskaras, see them for what they are, and when you do that, they weaken. They do not have the same power over you. So if you were a person who is very attracted to cars, you like nice cars, if you were to weaken that samskara, what would happen is that you would not be so attracted to cars anymore. It doesn't mean you give up the cars, but it just means that you won't freak out if somebody scratches your car a little bit, because you're no longer so attached to it. The kleshas have weakened. So this kind of purification can be done through dhyana. And that's what this verse is. Verse 11 is about purification. Generally, the example given is that of washing a piece of cloth which has stains on it. When you just wash it like you do regularly, you will find that that kind of washing is just enough to remove all the dirt, the normal dirt, you know, the general stains. But if you have a couple of really subtle stains on it which remain, you really have to work on those individually. So these two verses indicate something similar. Dhyana is a process where you'd work to weaken the samskaras. But for final liberation, you have to destroy them all by resolving them back into the original state, by having a direct experience of pure consciousness, and thereby knowing that all the seeds in the mind are not you. They're just seeds or kleshas, and when you're able to do that, they lose their power and you are free. You are a liberated being. Any questions about this? That's a good question, Manas. How to burn the seed in the fire of knowledge? Well, that's practice. You need a systematic method of practice, of sadhana, which goes from gross to subtle. And I have to add that just doing practice is not enough. The method, if it is a speedy method, that's great. But we need to understand that we need to live in this world and we need to work with the things we have around. Because this world is a wonderful place to live out our samskaras. We will be coming to that in the next group of verses, which is breaking the alliance between karma and kleshas, and that goes into detail with this. But what I do want to say is, in answer to that question, is that we do need guidance. The guidance is not only about doing practices. Guidance is about understanding oneself. And very often, it is difficult to develop a relationship with the teacher, because the job of the teacher is not to please the student. So what does happen sometimes is that students who are not ready and want to hear good things about themselves, they get very angry. And Ahankara does not like it. Some people have acquired a spiritual persona, spiritual identity. So they say, oh, I'm a very spiritual person. I have a spiritual talent. And so they get a bit of a shock when the teacher cuts down the ego. So there are some qualities that a student needs to bring before he can understand what systematic practice really means. So let's try to understand how we can break the alliance between karma and kleshas, how we can actually burn these seeds in the fire of knowledge. These are verses 12 to 25. A word of caution before we start this group of verses. The first few verses are not so difficult to understand, especially if you are actually doing some form of meditation. But verses 18 onwards, it gets a little bit more difficult, but hang in there. We don't have to understand everything. The reason is that if you've not had a certain experience, you will not understand it. But sometimes it's useful to know certain things, even if it is only theoretical knowledge. So verse 12, the reservoir of karma, karmashaya is called, which is rooted in kleshas, brings all kinds of experiences in present and future lives. So, what is the reservoir of karma? What is karmashaya? We talked about the seeds. That's what kleshas are. So these seeds are all here. We know that already. They are in the active and latent unconscious mind. And all these seeds here, they are there. The ones in the active unconscious mind are a little bit more conscious in the sense that you are a bit more aware of them. And the ones in the latent are unmanifest. They are the seed itself. And so if you look at this diagram, you can see that it's a whole group of these kleshas. They're all stored in here. This is like a reservoir, isn't it? This is a reservoir, and this is called karmashaya. It's all the impressions that are stored in the mind. And from these impressions, you perform karma or action out in this external world here. You don't perform action just one fine day. You perform an action because there's something in your mind here which motivates you to go out in the world and perform some action. If you think about anything you have done in your life, you will realize that before you actually manifested that out in the world, it was first a thought. It was first here in the unconscious mind. If you thought one fine day suddenly that you wanted to learn a musical instrument, it was maybe certainly a thought somewhere here in the unconscious mind. Maybe it was planted by somebody. Maybe you knew somebody who played beautifully the piano or the sitar, and you thought, I wish I could do that. And there you are. You have a thought or a desire, and it's in the conscious or unconscious mind. And so you go off and look for a class or a teacher who can teach you how to play the piano or the sitar. And there you are, you manifested it in the external world. That's true for any action that you have performed. Whether you got married, you decided to have children, what kind of a job you want, what kind of education you have, everything was first a thought. So this is the reservoir of our thoughts. And that's called karmashaya. So this is rooted in kleshas. That means that was full of kleshas, basically. You can call them kleshas, you can call them samskaras, different words for the same thing. And they bring about your experiences in the future and present lives. So whatever is in the mind comes forward, comes forward today or it comes forward tomorrow, obviously, it was there in the mind first. When you have desires which have been fulfilled from this reservoir, you see, that's how it builds up this connection between the two. When the desire is fulfilled, you get proud about it. So you had a desire to have a good job, and you got a job. Now you're working in a wonderful company like, I don't know, Google or Facebook, and it's very prestigious and everyone's very proud, and so are you. So what have you got? You have a new klesha now. You have a klesha of pride, muda. And then you got attached to that job. You got attached to the comforts which can come with that job. You have moha, attachment. And because of that job, you are earning very well. So now you get greedy because you want more money, or you want more perks, you want more comforts. And so that leads to more kleshas. So you see how it becomes a vicious circle, vicious cycle. If those kleshas are not fulfilled, or the samskaras are not fulfilled, you get angry. There's krodha, anger. So again, you have more kleshas. Or somebody else gets what you wanted. You get jealous. Matsarya. So more kleshas again. All this leads to further egoism or strengthening of these identities. So what has happened now? We realize, how do I get out of this? This is a vicious cycle. Because I have samskaras and kleshas, I'm acquiring more of them. And whatever I do or I don't do, I seem to acquire more of them. So verse 13 says, as long as the root, mula, as long as the root remains, the karma kshaya will ripen and result in birth, span of life and experience. So we see the root here in our diagram. I'm going to change this diagram slightly, and we see it now slightly different perspective. And we see that here's pure consciousness right on top. It's right here on top. And here is the latent and active. Here's conscious mind. Now, this is together, of course, and it's causing the formation of all these things out here. It's created a conscious mind, body, and the senses, and enjoying the things in the world. So it's a bit like a tree, which is upside down. This is these are the roots here, upside down. Think of it as these are the roots. This is the trunk of the tree here. These are the branches, the senses. And the fruit of the tree are the karma, the things that you enjoy. So now you see what you have is a tree that's upside down. It's known as the eternal tree. It has also been described in the Bhagavad Gita. It says there, the roots up and the branches hanging downwards. So this is the eternal tree. So we see there that as long as this root remains, and the root is all these kleshas, and the karmashaya itself, the samskaras. And as long as this karmashaya is there, they will ripen. It's like a fruit. It will come forward and manifest in the form of birth, span of life, and experience. What does that mean, birth? Yes, you will be born, but in what form? As an animal? As a plant? As a human being? When you realize that, you realize how fortunate and privileged you are that you have a human body. Because with a human body, you have a different awareness, different level of consciousness. You can live out the stuff which is in the reservoir of karma, in the karma share. You can live it out differently. You have much more freedom. You have will. And therefore, you can direct your own destiny. Animals cannot. They merely live out their destiny. Whatever is in the karma share comes forward and they have to live it out. But you can direct your destiny. Through meditation, the karma can fast fructify. That means it's like fast forwarding. You go through the whole thing, but very fast and very intensely. That happens when the method you use is speedy. For that, you have to have an extremely intense desire as well as a good method, very good method. And this helps you to burn up your samskaras faster in meditation or to live them out in the world and manifest them. That's called fast fructifying karma. Some karma is fast fructifying. Very, very little karma is fast fructifying. Primarily samadhi. When you experience samadhi, karma starts fructifying very fast. Through tapas. Tapa, which is done with deep bhava, so sadhana practices, deep practices, can lead to fast fructifying karma as well. Then there is the negative fast fructifying karma, which is of course not very nice. Evil actions manifest immediately and you get the result of that immediately as well. It's been classified in the Yoga Bhashyam of Vyasa. He said, if you do something evil, evil action against those who are frightened, those who come to you for refuge, and if you harm them, that's very evil. You will get the fruit of this directly. That means nothing positive, nothing nice, I'm afraid. If you perform evil action against those who are sick or old, or those who are very noble-minded, performing tapas, these are considered to be extremely evil action, and these are fast fructifying. So that you get the result of that evil in that lifetime itself. It's not something that is going back into the karma sphere and will manifest at some point of time in future. Rather, it will manifest in that lifetime itself, maybe even directly. So these two verses actually are very, very dense, very filled with meaning. And if you think about it in context of the diagram that we use, you see that the idea of renouncing as in tyaga is not necessarily the best idea, because this world is a place for us to manifest these very samskaras that we have stored in the karma share, in the unconscious mind. And if we do not still know how to burn them up in the fire of knowledge, but we do not allow them to manifest, then in effect you are stuck. You will not evolve. Do you understand how important that is? That for those people who acquire this idea that the world is a bad place because I'm practicing yoga and I'm now going to just not enjoy the world and I look down upon all these pleasures and things and worldly objects, you actually end up in a very difficult situation because you have not learned still how to actually burn these in the fire of knowledge. And then you're stuck. You're stuck with them. You stop evolving. You stop growing. Any questions about that? I would say that verse 12 and 13 are really very important for our understanding of the world and why the world is not just a bad place, but in fact it's a playground. It's a place for us to live out our samskaras. So maybe we have some time to do verse 14. So verse 14 is not especially difficult. Basically, it says that virtue and vice, punya and apunya, are the causes of pleasure and pain. They have pain and pleasure is the fruit. So we talked about birth, and we said that having a human body is a great privilege. Your samskaras, the unconscious mind, will provide you with a body, a suitable body, to live out those very samskaras. So you ask about why certain some people are born into families where they have so many opportunities and others are born into families or countries where maybe they have lesser opportunities. That's because of your samskaras. It's the samskaras which lead us into the kind of family we are born into, the kind of background we come from. It also determines your lifespan, whether you will have a very short-lived life or a long-lived life depends also on your samskaras. If you have an attitude that the world is a horrible place, then it is quite likely that you will have a shorter lifespan because you do not really want to be here in this plane of existence. But if you see the world as a wonderful place to live out these samskaras, as a great privilege and opportunity to evolve, to speeden up this evolution by learning practices and doing great sadhana, then you will have a long life. Then it is even desirable to have a long life. It will also make you experience things, what is called bhoga. It is pleasure and pain. This also is determined by the samskaras. That is what you have in your unconscious mind. So, this is a wonderful study of our yogic anatomy there. It goes into the details of it. We will continue the next session to understand how we can break this alliance. It's not easy, but it is possible. It's possible in this lifetime. And if you're determined to do that, if you have the sankalp, if you have the determination, if you have a good method, you have a teacher who is gentle but firm, then it is possible. It is not likely if you do not have a systematic practice or a teacher, for the simple reason that there are very few people who can do that. If you have already evolved to the level where through your samskaras you already have had those experiences in the past lives, and then you're a highly evolved soul, then it is possible that you can even do this on your own. But this is really the exception. So we do have sages, modern sages like Rama Maharishi, for example, who had no teacher. And he went off and he sat in a cave and he did his practice, and he was an evolved soul. So even if one has had these glimpses and has had these insights, systematic practice will help shorten this whole process, because it's a speedy method. If you're going to do all your experimentation yourself and you're going to try to figure it out all on your own by reading books and looking at websites and making your own little practice, that's fine. Maybe it works, but it's probably going to take much longer. So it's a very useful to have a tried and tested method and an experienced teacher. Okay, thank you very much for being there. We continue next time. And Sachin, I don't know if you got to my emails because you didn't answer. So thank you, Perry. It was nice having you again. And thanks, Manoj. Also, bye-bye, everybody. Bye, Miklash. Bye, Manisha. So bye, everyone. Bye, Sachin. Sachin, did you get my message? Please, maybe you can just write me a short answer so I know that you got it.